Nudged Audiobooks presents Dial a Ghost by Eva Ibbotson, narrated by Susan Jameson. Chapter 1. The Wilkinson family became ghosts quite suddenly during the Second World War when a bomb fell on their house. The house was called Rest Haven, after the hotel where Mr. and Mrs. Wilkinson had spent their honeymoon, and you couldn't have found a nicer place to live. It had bow windows and a blue front door and stained glass in the bathroom and a garden with a bird table and a lily pond. Mrs. Wilkinson kept everything spotless and her husband, Mr. Wilkinson, was a dentist who went to town every day to fill people's teeth. They had a son called Eric who was 13 when the bomb fell. He was a Boy Scout and had just started having spots and falling in love with girls who sneered at him. Also living in the house were Mrs. Wilkinson's mother, who was a fierce old lady with a dangerous umbrella, and Mrs. Wilkinson's sister Trixie, a pale, fluttery person to whom bad things were always happening. The family had been getting ready to go to the air raid shelter at the bottom of the garden, and they were collecting the things they needed. Grandma took her umbrella and her gas mask case, which did not hold her gas mask but a bottle labelled poison, which she meant to drink if there was an invasion, rather than fall into enemy hands. Mrs. Wilkinson gathered up her knitting and unhooked the budgie's cage, and Eric took a book called Scouting for Boys and the letter he was writing to a girl called Cynthia Harbottle. In the hall they met Mr. Wilkinson, who'd just come in and was changing into his khaki uniform. He belonged to the Home Guard, a brave band of part-time soldiers who practiced crawling through the undergrowth and shooting things when they'd finished work. "Hurry up, everyone," he said. "The planes are getting closer." But just then they remembered that poor Trixie was still in her upstairs bedroom, wrapped in a flag. The flag was her costume for a show the Women's Institute was putting on for the gallant soldiers, and Trixie had been chosen to be the Spirit of Britain, and to come on in a Union Jack. "I'll just go and fetch her," said Mrs. Wilkinson, who knew that Trixie had not been at all happy with the way she looked and might be too shy to come down and join them. She began to climb the stairs, and then the bomb fell, and that was that. Of course, it was a shock, realising that they had suddenly become ghosts. "Fancy me a spook," said Grandma, shaking her head. Still, there they were, a bit pale and shimmery, of course, but not looking so different from the way they had before. Grandma always wore her best hat to the shelter, the one with the bunch of cherries trimmed with lover's knots, and the whiskers on her chin stuck out like daggers in the moonlight. Eric was in his scout uniform with the woggle and the badge to show he was a pathfinder, and his spectacles were still on his nose. Only the budgie didn't look too good. He'd lost his tail feathers and seemed to have become rather a small bird. "Oh, Henry, what shall we do now?" asked Mrs. Wilkinson. The top half of her husband was dressed like a soldier, in a tin hat which he'd draped with leaves so as to make him look like a bush, but the bottom half was dressed like a dentist, and Mrs. Wilkinson, who loved him very much, glided close to him and looked up into his face. "We shall do what we did before, Maud," said Mr. Wilkinson. "Live decent lives and serve our country." "At least we're all together," said Grandma. But then a terrible silence fell, and as the spectres looked at each other, their ectoplasm turned as white as snow. "Where is Trixie?" faltered Mrs. Wilkinson. "Where is my dear sister?" Where, indeed? They searched what was left of the house. They searched the garden. They called and called. But there was no sign of a shy spook with spectacles, dressed in nothing but a flag. For poor Maud Wilkinson, this was an awful blow. She cried, she moaned, she wrung her hands. "I promised Mother I would look after her," she wailed. "I've always looked after Trixie." This was true. Maud and Trixie's mother had run a stage dancing school, and ever since they were little, Maud had helped her nervy sister to be a sugar puff, or a baby swan, or dandelion. But there was nothing to be done. Why some people become ghosts and others don't is a mystery that no one has ever solved. The next years passed uneventfully. The war ended, but nobody came to rebuild their house, and the Wilkinsons lived in it much as they did before. It was completely ruined, but they could remember where all the rooms were. And in a way, being a ghost is simple. You don't feel the cold or have to go to school, and they soon got the hang of passing through walls and vanishing. Having Mr. Wilkinson to explain things to them was a great help, of course. "You have to remember," he said, "that while people are made of muscle and skin and bone, ghosts are made of ectoplasm. But that does not mean," he went on sternly, "that we can allow ourselves to become feeble and woozy and faint. Ectoplasm can be strengthened just the way that muscles can." But however busy they were doing knee bends and press-ups and learning to move things by the power of their will, they never forgot poor Trixie. Every single evening as the sun went down, they went into the garden and called her. They called her from the north, they called her from the south and the east and the west, but the sad goose-pimpled spook never appeared. Then, when they'd been phantoms for about 15 years, something unexpected happened. They found the ghost of a lost child. They were out for an early morning glide in the fields near their house when they saw a white shape lying in the grass under the shelter of a hedge. "Goodness, do you think it's a passed-on sheep?" asked Mrs. Wilkinson. But when they got closer, they saw that it was not the ghost of a sheep that lay there. It was the ghost of a little girl. She wore an old-fashioned nightdress with a ribbon round the neck and one embroidered slipper. And though she was fast asleep, the string of a rubber sponge bag was clasped in her hand. "She must be a ghost from olden times," said Mrs. Wilkinson excitedly. "Look at the stitching on that nightdress. You don't get sewing like that nowadays." "She looks wet," said Grandma. This was true. Drops of water glistened in her long, tousled hair, and her one bare foot looked damp. "Perhaps she drowned," suggested Eric. Mr. Wilkinson opened the sponge bag. Inside it was a toothbrush, a tin of tooth powder with a picture of Queen Victoria on the lid, and a fish. It was a wild fish, not the kind that lives in tanks, but it too was a ghost and could tell them nothing. "It must have floated into the sponge bag when she was in the water," said Mr. Wilkinson. But the thing to do now was to wake the child, and this was difficult. She didn't seem to be just asleep. She seemed to be in a coma. In the end, it was the budgie who did it by saying, "Open wide!" in his high, squawking voice. He'd learned to say this when his cage hung in the dentist's surgery, because it was what Mr. Wilkinson said to his patients when they sat down in the dentist's chair. "Oh, the sweet thing!" cried Mrs. Wilkinson, as the child stirred and stretched. "Isn't she a darling? I'm sure she's lost. And if she is, she must come and make her home with us, mustn't she, Henry? We must adopt her." She bent over the child. "What's your name, dear? Can you remember what you're called?" The girl's eyes were open now, but she was still not properly awake. "Adopt her," she repeated. And then in a stronger voice, "Adopt her." "Adopt her?" repeated Mrs. Wilkinson. "That's an odd name. But very pretty." So that was what she came to be called, though they often called her Addie for short. She never remembered anything about her past life. And Mr. Wilkinson, who knew things, said she had had concussion, which is a blow on the head that makes you forget your past. Mr. and Mrs. Wilkinson never pretended to be her parents. She was told to call them Uncle Henry and Aunt Maud. But she hadn't been with them for more than a few weeks before they felt that she was the daughter they'd always longed for. and the greatest comfort in the troubled times that now began, because life now became very difficult. Their house was rebuilt, and the people who moved in were the kind that couldn't see ghosts. They thought nothing of putting a plate of scrambled eggs down on Grandma's head, or running the Hoover through Eric when he wanted to be quiet and think about why Cynthia Harbottle didn't love him. And when they left, another set of people moved in who could see ghosts. And that was even worse. Every time any of the Wilkinsons appeared, they shrieked and screamed and fainted, which was terribly hurtful. "I could understand it if we were headless," said Aunt Maud. "I'd expect to be screamed at if I was headless." "Or blood-stained," agreed Grandma. "But we have always kept ourselves decent, and the children too." Then the new people stopped screaming and started talking about getting the ghosts exorcised. And after that, there was nothing for it. They left their beloved rest haven and went away to find another home. Chapter 2. The Wilkinsons went to London thinking there'd be a lot of empty houses there. But this was a mistake. No place was more bombed in the war, and it was absolutely packed with ghosts. Ghosts in swimming baths and ghosts in schools, ghosts whooping about in bus stations, ghosts in factories and offices or playing about with computers, and older ghosts too, from a bygone age, knights in armour wandering round Indian takeaways, wailing nuns in toy shops, and all of them looking completely flaked out and muddled. In the end, the Wilkinsons found a shopping arcade which didn't seem too crowded. It had all sorts of shops in it, shoe shops and grocer's shops and sweet shops, and a bunion shop, which puzzled a doctor.
"Can you buy bunions, Aunt Maud?" she asked, looking at the big wooden foot in the window with a leather bunion nailed to one toe.
"No, dear, bunions are nasty bumps that people get on the side of their toes. But you can buy things to make bunions better, like sticking plaster and ointments." But the bunion shop was already haunted by a frail ghost called Mr. Hoffman, a German professor who'd made himself quite ill by looking at the bowls for spitting into and the rubber tubes and the wall charts showing what could go wrong with people's livers, which was plenty. So they went to live in a knicker shop. A doctor called it the knicker shop, but of course no one can make a living just by selling knickers. It sold pyjamas and swimsuits and nightdresses and vests, but none of them were at all like the pyjamas and swimsuits and vests the Wilkinsons were used to.
"In my day, knickers were long and decent, with elastic at the knee and pockets to keep your hanky in," grumbled Grandma. "And those bikinis! I was 25 before I saw my first tummy button. And look at those hussies in the fitting rooms, shameless, I call it."
"It's the children I'm bothered about," said Aunt Maud. "They shouldn't be seeing such things. And really, some of the clothes sold in that shop were not nice. Suspender belts that were just a row of frills, and see-through slips and transparent boxes full of briefs."
"Brief what's?" snorted Grandma.
Still, they really tried to settle down and make a life for themselves. A doctor was put to sleep in the office, where she wouldn't be among pantalettes and tights with rude names, and Uncle Henry stayed among the socks, because there's a limit to how silly you can get with socks. They hung the budgie's cage on the rack beside the Wonder Bras and told themselves that they were lucky to have a roof over their heads at all. But they were not happy. The shopping arcade was stuffy. The people wandering up and down it looked greedy and bored. They missed the garden at Rest Haven and the green fields, and although they went out and called Trixie every night, they couldn't help wondering whether a shy person dressed in a flag would dare to appear in such a crowded place, even if she heard them. Aunt Maud did everything she could to make the knicker shop into a proper home. She arranged cobwebs on the ceiling and brought in dead thistles from the graveyard and rubbed mould into the walls.
But the lady who sold the knickers was a demon with the floor polisher. She was another one who couldn't see ghosts, and though they slept all day and tried to keep out of her way, she was forever barging through them or spinning the poor budgie round as she twiddled the Wonder Bras on their stand. Grandma was getting bothered about Mr. Hoffman in the bunion shop, who was coming up with more and more diseases. And Eric had started counting his spots again and writing awful poetry to Cynthia Harbottle. "But, Eric, we've been ghosts for years and years," his mother would cry. "Cynthia'd be a fat old lady by now." But this only hurt Eric, who said that to him she would always be young, and he would glide off to the greetings card shop to see if he could find anything to rhyme with Cynthia, or Harbottle, or both. "Oh, Henry, do you think we shall ever have a proper home again?" poor Maud would cry, and her husband would pat her back and tell her to be patient and never let on that when he was pretending to go to the dental hospital to study new ways of filling teeth, he was really house hunting and had found nothing at all. But Aunt Maud's worst worry was about a doctor. Addie was becoming a street ghost. She often stayed out all night, and she was picking up bad habits and mixing with completely the wrong sort of ghost. Ghosts who'd been having a bath when their house caught fire and hadn't had time to put on any clothes. The ghosts of rat catchers and vulgar people who swore and drank in pubs. And she was always bringing in the most unsuitable pets. Addie had always been crazy about animals. She liked living animals, but of course for a ghost to drag living animals about is silly. And the ones that held her heart were the creatures that had passed on and become ghosts and didn't quite understand what had happened to them. But it was one thing to fill the garden at Rest Haven with phantom hedgehogs and rabbits and moles, and quite another to keep a run-over alley cat or a battered pigeon among the satin pyjamas and the leotards. "Please, dear, no more strays," begged Aunt Maud. "After all, you have the budgie and your dear fish." But though she wouldn't have hurt Aunt Maud for the world, Addie couldn't help feeling that a bird who said nothing but "open wide" and "my name is Billy" wasn't very interesting. Nor was her fish much fun. He stayed in the sponge bag and did absolutely nothing. And though a doctor didn't blame him, she longed for an exciting pet, something unusual. So she began to haunt London Zoo. And it was on the way back from there one winter's night that she saw something that was to change all their lives. She had had her eye on a duck-billed platypus, which had not looked at all well the day before. Its brown fur looked limp and dull. Its eyes were filmed over, and its big flat beak seemed to be covered in some kind of mould. Of course, she knew that even if it died, the duckbill would not necessarily become a ghost. Animals are the same as people. Some become ghosts and some don't. Even so, as she glided towards its cage, a doctor was full of hope. She imagined taking it to bed with her, holding it in her arms. No one had such an unusual pet. And though Aunt Maud would make a fuss at the beginning, she was far too kind to turn it out into the street. But a great disappointment awaited her. The silly keeper must have given the duckbill some medicine because it looked much better. In fact, it looked fine. It was lumbering round the cage like a 2-year-old and eating a worm. Perhaps it was because she was so sad about her lost pet that she took a wrong turning on the way home to the knicker shop. The street she was gliding down was not the one she went down usually. She was just about to turn back when she saw a sign above a tall grey house. It was picked out in blue electric light bulbs, and what it said was, "Adopt a ghost." Addie braked hard and stared at it. She was utterly amazed. "But that's extraordinary," she said. "That is my name. I'm called Adopter, and I'm a ghost." She floated up to the roof and stared at the letters. "Is it my house?" she wondered. "Is it a house for me?" But that didn't seem very likely. Could there be two adopter ghosts in the world?
Was this the home of a very grand spook with a green skin and hollow eyes? A queenly spook with trailing dresses, ordering everyone about? But when she peered through the windows, she saw that the rooms looked rather dull. Offices with files and a desk and a telephone. A queenly spook with green ectoplasm would never live in a place like that. Very much excited, Addie hurried home. "Aunt Maud, you must come at once," she said. "I've seen the most amazing thing."
"Addie, it's your bedtime. It's nearly 8 in the morning. They'll be opening the shop in half an hour."
"Please," begged the doctor. "I just know this is important."
So Maud came and landed on the ledge beneath the notice. And when she'd done so, she was quite as excited as the child had been. "My dear, it doesn't say adopter ghost. Look carefully and you'll see a space between the middle letters. It says adopt a ghost. And I really believe it's an agency to find homes for people like us. Look, there's a notice. Ghosts wanting to be rehoused should register between midnight and 3 a.m. on Tuesdays, Thursdays or Saturdays." She turned to the child and hugged her.
"Oh, Addie, I do believe our troubles are over. There is someone who cares about us, someone who really and truly cares."
Chapter 3. Aunt Maud was right. There was someone who cared about ghosts, and who cared about them very much. Two people, to be exact. Miss Pringle, who was small and twittery, with round blue eyes, and Mrs. Mannering, who was big and bossy and wore jackets with huge shoulder pads and had a booming voice. The two ladies had met in an evening class for witches. They were interested in unusual ways of living and thought they might have had special powers, which would have been nice, but they hadn't enjoyed the classes at all. They were held in a basement near Paddington Station, and the other people there had wanted to do things that Miss Pringle and Mrs. Mannering could not possibly approve of, like doing anti-clockwise dances dressed in nothing but their underclothes and sticking pins into puppets which had taken some poor person a long time to make. All the same, the classes must have done some good, because afterwards both the ladies found that they were much better than they had been before at seeing ghosts. They'd always been able to see ghosts in a vague and shimmery way, but now they saw them as clearly as if they had been ordinary people, and they did not like what they saw. There were ghosts eating their hearts out in cinemas and bottle factories. There were headless warriors in all-night garages, and blood-stained brides who rode round and round the underground because they had nowhere to sleep. And it was then they got the idea for the agency. For after all, if people can adopt whales and trees in rainforests, if schoolchildren can adopt London buses and crocodiles in the zoo, why not ghosts? Only they'd have to be proper adoptions, not just sending money. Ghosts, after all, are not whales or crocodiles. They can perfectly well fit into the right sort of house.
There might be people who would be only too happy to have a ghost or two in their stately home to attract tourists, said Miss Pringle.
And they'd be splendid for keeping off burglars, said Mrs. Mannering.
So they decided to start an agency and call it Dial a Ghost. Miss Pringle had some money and was glad to spend it in such a useful way. She was a very kind person, but a little vague, and it was Mrs. Mannering who knew what to do about furnishing the office and getting filing cabinets and putting out leaflets. It was she, too, who arranged for separate doors, one saying ghosts and one saying people, and printed the notice explaining that they would see ghosts on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Saturdays, and people who wanted to adopt them on the other days. But it was kind, dithery Miss Pringle who engaged the office boy. He was called Ted, and she gave him the job because he looked hungry and his parents were out of work. He was a nice boy, but there was something he hadn't told the ladies. And this something turned out to be important. After the agency had been going for a few months, Miss Pringle and Mrs. Mannering began to specialise. Miss Pringle dealt with the gentle, peaceful goats, the sad ladies who'd been left at the altar on their wedding days and jumped off cliffs, and the cold, white little children who'd fallen off roofs in their boarding schools, and so on. And Mrs. Mannering coped with the fierce ones, the ones that were livid and revolting and rattled their chains. And every evening when they'd finished work, the two ladies went to the Dirty Duck and ordered a port and lemon and told each other how their day had gone.
"I had such a delightful family in just now," said Miss Pringle. "The Wilkinsons.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.